It was a perfect day in Coonamble, just ideal for taking a stroll around this rather unique historical town. Coonamble, a small rural service town of about 3,000 people, is known for its sheep and cattle grazing and dry land broadacre cropping. It is situated on the Castlereagh River, which is an upside down or underground river, though there was plenty of water above ground when we were there. As it turned out, we had only a few hours to spend here, as we were heading for our next destination, Lightning Ridge. So we squeezed in as much as we could in our limited time. Down by the river is the town's museum, which is housed in the old police station building constructed in 1886. The commercial hotel on the corner of Castlereagh and Aberford Streets was built in 1912, replacing the original building of 1876. A unique feature of the main street is the Coonamble Nickname Hall of Fame. Caricatures of colourful local identities are found on various walls throughout Castlereagh Street. In 1929, a disastrous fire raced through the town, destroying 38 of the main street buildings. Several of the buildings were rebuilt a year later. One of these is the Plaza Theatre, which replaced the original Monarch Picture Theatre. Another is the huge Tattersall's Hotel, renamed Sons of the Soil in 1984. Some of the buildings were rebuilt in the fashionable Art Deco style of the time. There are many other significant buildings, including the Post Office, built in 1881, and St Barnabas Church of England, first built in 1875 and rebuilt in 1909. At the top of Castlereagh Street is the Peace Tree, planted in 1996 to honour the memory of those who served in World War II. From Coonamble, we travelled the 195 kilometres north to Lightning Ridge. Not far from Lightning Ridge, we came across Stanley, the 18-metre high steel emu. Stanley is the brainchild of Lightning Ridge artist John Murray. According to the plaque, sometime around 1870, a shepherd, his dog and 600 sheep were struck dead by lightning here. From then on, the area was unofficially known as Lightning Ridge, until the name was gazetted in 1963. It's interesting to note that John Murray originally intended Stanley to be located on the Birdsville track, but the tyranny of distance, remoteness and bureaucracy led to Stanley being a no-show at Birdsville. About 10 kilometres on, we found the turnoff to the town itself. As all the signs were indicating, Lightning Ridge is famous for its rare black opal. The black opal was prized not only for its rarity, but also because it has carbon and iron oxide trace elements, which produce a very dark stone with hints of blue, green and red. Once we had settled into our caravan park, we took a look around town. Out front of the Historical Society Cottage is a bronze statue of prospector and miner Charlie Nettleton, Although opals were being discovered in the area by the 1870s, Charlie is regarded as the founder of the black opal industry. This early cottage survives as an example of making do with whatever building materials are available. The town is well serviced with shops, motels and markets, with stores selling opals predominating. Although the resident population is only about 2,600, Lightning Ridge attracts over 80,000 tourists, visitors and itinerants each year. Just out of town is the 18-hole golf course, a challenge to the best of players with its black sand greens and hard gravel fairways. Opposite the golf course is the Lightning Ridge Cemetery. Although there are relatively few formal headstones, every grave has been acknowledged, though sadly some are unknown. After picking up some information for the visitor centre, we went on a couple of car door tours. These are self-drive tours where you follow colour-coded car doors or the like, with numbers and directions to points of interest that correspond to numbers on an information sheet. And you do need directions, as there is a maze of tracks around the ridge. The red door tour was through the original settlement on the opal fields, called Wallangulla or Old Town. The buildings here are still being constructed from local materials, and that seems to include bottles. A sense of humour is definitely incorporated into the next residence, which also offers B&B accommodation. Then there's Amigo's Castle, which has been growing room by room, turret by turret, tower by tower since 1985. Apparently there were still enough bottles from the never-ending supply to build a bottle house and museum. The art creations of Don Murray are synonymous with the ridge, as are his murals, which are found on walls all around town. Blue Door Tour takes you to the walk-in mine on Bald Hill. Dug by hand in the 1960s, it is considered to be Lightning Ridge's first tourist attraction. Bevan's Black Opal and Cactus Nursery has over 2,300 species, making it the largest collection of cactus in the Southern Hemisphere. The Yellow Car Door Tour drives through the three mild fields, the largest of the opal fields. There are many stone miners' cottages on these fields. Most are off-grid, using solar, fuel-powered generators and wind power. The old 3 Mile Open Cut mine is to be the site of the proposed new Australian Opal Centre. The underground energy-efficient building showcasing everything about opals will be a world-class tourist attraction. Further on, and heading up to Lunatic Hill, are ruins, relics, and the occasional mine shaft. Over 50 years, the heavily mined ridge at Lunatic Hill was becoming too dangerous for underground mining, so open-cut mining commenced. This resulted in the largest open-cut mine in New South Wales. The hill got its name when the talk was that only lunatics would go up there, as to reach the opal-producing level, a man had to dig three times as deep as he would on the flat. But it turned out to be well worthwhile. Chambers of the Black Hand sounds very sinister, but this tourist mine is just named after an old black painted sign cut out in the shape of a hand. One non-opal bearing level of the mine has been dedicated to carvings, with as many chambers filled with hundreds of sculptures.
So he's actually dug this whole sandstone level out here. There's no opal up here. It's in that clay level further down. Ron's dug all this out over 24 years just to do carvings.
Yes,
gosh. All started back in 97. He just hand cut those steps all the way from the surface by himself. He wanted to do a walk down tourism mine where he could invite people down. So he did them all the way to the bottom level there. Yeah. Done it as a bet with one of his mates. It ended up taking him 6 months and he won $100. It wasn't the best bet that he'd ever done.
No.
He's had no formal lessons, no art classes or anything. It's all self-taught. So first chamber, humble beginnings, and he just got better and better as he went along.
All these carvings were created by miner and artist Ron Canlin, using the tools of his trade, a jackhammer and pickaxe, and a few kitchen utensils. When it became apparent that the mine was not sustainable as a source of opal, he decided to invite tourists in. His interest in carving flourished with his newfound talent, and the mine grew into the world-class tourist attraction we see today. In the underground shop, there was an array of opals and jewellery to admire or purchase, and the opportunity to see one of Ron's carving tools that has been reshaped with years of use.
There's three little opals on each side. He put bloody solids on it too, as well. And the funny part about it all is that he lost it a couple of Easters ago. He had it in his pocket and it fell out of his pocket up in the car park. He's running around down here in a fluster. Where's my knife? And that, and this girl said, oh, I said, I saw a knife up in the car park. He said, oh, you know, he took her up there, sure enough, here it is, lying in the car park, the opal sparkling away on the handle, nobody picked them
lucky.
Up. And that anyway, he come back down with the girl and that, then he got his tin out and he gave her a couple of stones.
We'd only allowed ourselves a couple of nights at the ridge, and it was obviously not enough to see and do everything. But the weather had caught up with us, so it was time to move on.